good morning. Happy 4th of July weekend. At this time, we will be saying the Pledge of Allegiance, followed by the Star Spangled Banner. Attention, salute, pledge. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
July weekend. I'm looking forward to praising God and thanking Him for our country and also for the freedom we have in Christ. For those of you who do not know, I am Jonathan James and I will be preaching in Pastor Peyton's place as he enjoys his much-deserved vacation. Anyways, now we will sing America the Beautiful.
Just
to say this again, but actually, if you all would please honor the scripture and stand as we... It's okay. No, you're fine. And that scripture is from Luke chapter 5, verses 1 through 11. And a little exercise doesn't hurt nobody, so it's okay. Once again, the scripture will be Luke chapter 5, verses 1 through 11. If you all would please turn there with me and follow along as we honor the reading of God's word. Beginning at verse 1. One day, as Jesus was standing by the lake of Gennesaret, also called the Sea of Galilee, the people were crowding around him and listening to the word of God. He saw at the water's edge two boats left there by the fishermen who were washing their nets. He got into one of the boats, the one belonging to Simon, who would later be called Peter, and asked him to put out a little from shore. Then he sat down and taught the people from the boat. When he had finished speaking, he said to Simon, "Put out into deep water and let down the nets for a catch." Simon answered, "Master, we worked hard all night and haven't caught anything, but because you say so, I will let down the nets." When they had done so, they caught such a large number of fish that their nets began to break. So they signaled to their partners in the other boat to come and help them. And they came and filled both boats so full that they began to sink. When Simon Peter saw this, he fell at Jesus' knees and said, "Go away from me, Lord. I am a sinful man." For he and all his companions were astonished at the catch of fish they had taken. And so were James and John, the sons of Zebedee, Simon's partners. Then Jesus said to Simon, "Don't be afraid. From now on, you will fish for people." So they pulled their boat up on shore, left everything, and followed him. Thank you all. And now you may be seated. If y'all would please bow with me in prayer. Father, I thank you for this day. I also thank you for our country, the freedom we enjoy here, to be able to gather like this, to be able to worship you publicly, declare the gospel without fear of persecution. God, it is a blessing, and we must not take it for granted. We must praise you and thank you for it. God, I also thank you for your word, and I pray you'll open our eyes to your word. I pray you will teach us. I pray you will guide the sermon and guide the worship service and help us to praise you with all our hearts. In Jesus' name, amen. And Papa John, will you please come up and lead us in the song?
How's everyone this morning? I'm going to ask if I could get everyone to help me out with this. It's three places in the song where we echo "Jesus saves." And I'll raise my arm like that, and it all happens fast, so you gotta be ready to say it. But everybody sing along with me, "Jesus saves." Walk all over this land and tell the world that Jesus saves, Jesus saves. I'll go where he leads me, wherever that may be, and I'll tell the world that Jesus saves. The book says, put on the armor of the Lord with the shield of faith before you, the word of the living God, your only sword. Let your feet be shod with the gospel of peace and understanding, and go to all the arrows. I go with my tongue made free to speak his word. And I thank him for these new shoes that take me where he leads me. And I'll tell the world that he is Lord of lords. I'm wearing new shoes now. I'm gonna walk all over this land and tell the world that Jesus saves, Jesus saves. I'll go where he leads me, wherever that may be. And I'll tell the world that Jesus saves. I'll go where he leads me, wherever that may be. And I'll tell the world that Jesus, Jesus saves. And I'll tell the world that Jesus saves.
Amen. Thank you, Papa John. I just love it when the song just goes so well with the message. And let me tell you, that's just perfect with the message that I felt God leading me to share with us this morning. So without further ado, let's go ahead and get started with that. I will say that as we've been celebrating the freedom we enjoy in America, I couldn't totally shake off my concern for her, for our country. We, the people right now, are very divided, are very hurt, and are very angry. And America's turmoil really reveals the age-old problem that has plagued every individual, every one of us, and simply, that is sin. And what America needs, what we need, what our community needs, what the world needs, is revival. Revival from the gospel, the good news, life-changing power, and God's Holy Spirit. But if that's going to happen, we need to rise up in the fervor of the Lord and the Spirit of the Lord. We need to be radically different from the rest of the world. We need to be radically different followers of Jesus. Unfortunately, I think if we're honest, sometimes, myself included, we must admit, we fall short of that. Sometimes our love for the Lord, our passion for Him, our evangelism, it fades. So what can we do to move from being a casual follower of Jesus to a radically different follower of Jesus? And I believe the answer to that question is here in Luke chapter 5, verses 1 through 11. So we're going to take a look at how Jesus took these four ordinary fishermen and turned them into radically different followers who would go on to change the world. And we're going to ask ourselves, how can he do this in us today so we can do the same in our time? So if you will, please get it out again and turn to Luke chapter 5, verses 1 through 11. And before we dive in, I just want to share a little bit of the context. At this point, Jesus has begun his public ministry. He may not have his 12 disciples, but he has gone public. He is also known at this point as a famous teacher and miracle worker. So it's no surprise to see that this passage begins with a crowd pressing up against Jesus, wanting to hear him teach the word of God. And then we see that Jesus wants some social distancing on the beach, so he hops in Peter's boat and ask him to put it out from the shore. And Peter listens, lets him use his boat while they're sitting there cleaning their nets and mending them. And Jesus uses that boat like a pulpit and he teaches the crowd. And then we see in verse 4, after he's done speaking, he turns his attention to these fishermen, in particular to Peter. And he tells them, hey, go take out this boat and cast your nets down in the deep water. And Peter's got to be thinking again. I mean, remember, we must keep in mind, as Peter will soon tell Jesus, they've been fishing all night in the wee hours of the morning when it was the best time to fish, and they caught nothing, absolutely nothing. So these fishermen had to be very tired. Not only that, while Jesus was speaking, they were busy cleaning their nets. They were packing up to go home to get some rest. That's like finishing our job and then being told, go back to work immediately. So it was an exasperating command we see Jesus gave to Peter. And I think the reason why is because Jesus was testing Peter's faith in him. And I think it's important that we remember this is not Peter's first time meeting Jesus. And for at least three other of these fishermen, it's not their first time meeting Jesus. No, we know from the book of John that John the Baptist pointed some of them, specifically Andrew and possibly James and John, and he saw Jesus walking by and he said, there goes the Messiah. And they started following Jesus, and Andrew called his brother Peter. So they followed Jesus for a time, down when he was in Judea. But as it says in John, when they came back to Galilee, evidently, these fishermen went right back to fishing. And why wouldn't they? At that point, they were just casual followers of Jesus. They haven't seen his glory. They haven't been dramatically changed by him. As Peter would say later, they haven't found out, in you are the words of everlasting life. How can I leave you? They haven't experienced that yet. Jesus hasn't called them. But Jesus, as he begins his public ministry, knows, I need to train up disciples, and they need to be radically different from my casual followers. They're going to change the world. God's going to use them to build my church. And that's exactly what Jesus needs today. So we see anyways that Peter passes the faith test. He goes out and he listens to what Jesus said. He does tell him, by the way, all the reasons why he shouldn't listen to him. I've been fishing all night. But he does say, because you say so, I will do it anyways. Isn't that something that every mom would love to hear? They always tell their children, why do I have to listen to you? Because I say so. And here we see Jesus tested Peter, and Peter respects him. He has faith in him. He knows he's a rabbi from God, a teacher from God. And he listens. And when he does, they get a miracle, a huge catch of fish. When he lets down his net, it says there were so many fish, the net began to tear. He had to call over his other fishing buddies and their boat to help haul it all in. And even then, the scripture says both boats started to sink. So this was a huge catch of fish, and it had to really amaze them. But now we get to the part where we start seeing how Jesus transformed these four ordinary fishermen into radically different followers. This is a time we need to pay attention to, listen up. And we're going to be looking at verses 8 through 11 especially. And I would say how Jesus changed these fishermen into the radically different followers he wanted was he used this miracle to open their eyes to three realities. He used this miracle to open their eyes to three realities. And what those three realities are is one, God's awesomeness. Two, sin's awfulness. And three, Christ's absolution, the amazing grace we have in Christ. So we're going to take a look at where exactly we see that in this passage. So if you will, look at verse 9 with me. And you will see in verse 9, it says, he, Peter, and all his companions were astonished at the catch of fish they had taken. These men were amazed. And why were they amazed? Because they just saw the awesomeness of God. Who else could have done that miracle than God? They were beginning to probably wonder if there were any fish left in the Sea of Galilee after fishing all night. And then we see that God in his sovereignty and his power gets all those fish right where they need to be. And that what? At the command of Jesus. That Jesus telling them, go fish in the deep water. So we see that these fishermen have just experienced the awesome power of God present there with them and affirming Jesus as a man from God. So they are amazed. They are utterly astonished. But we also look and see that for Peter, this amazement leads to him seeing a second reality. A second reality, and it creates in him an emotional crisis. And you look at, we see that Luke explains Peter's reaction in verse 8 with his amazement in verse 9. His amazement that God's awesomeness has now compelled him to realize sinfulness. It's compelled him to realize specifically his own sin and how awful it is. And as we can see from this passage, Peter was immediately stricken with humility and fear. We see that he fell at Jesus' knees in verse 8. He called him Lord. And we also see in verse 10, at the end of it, Jesus tells him, do not be afraid. Peter was afraid. Peter was fearful. And why was that? Because he knew that God was here among them, that this man was from God, and he knew that God hates sin. He knew that God is the just judge of the earth, and that therefore God's justice is against him because he is a sinful man. And he was afraid. He knew he was unworthy. He knew that he had awful sin in him, and he didn't deserve God's presence. He was fearful of God's presence and of condemnation. What a horrible place to be in, but a place we all must come to. Peter's not the only one in the Bible to reach that conclusion, to feel that way, when he saw the awesomeness of God. Remember Job? After God spoke to him from the storm, Job said, what my ears have heard, my eyes have now seen, and I despise myself and repent in dust and ashes. Remember Isaiah, the prophet, who when he saw a heavenly vision of God's glory and majesty, and God was seated in a throne in heaven, and he said, woe to me, I'm going to die. I'm an unclean man with unclean lips, and I live among a people with unclean lips. Just like Peter, these men were stricken with humility and fear at the awesomeness of God because they realized the awfulness of sin in them. And Peter, that feeling led him to say, go away from me, Lord. He wanted nothing to do with Jesus. He couldn't stand the presence. He was afraid. Aren't you glad Jesus didn't leave him? Aren't you glad God doesn't leave us in that place and the despair of our sins, realizing how awful it is and that we're under justice and rightly so? And God doesn't leave us there. He shows us a third reality, which Jesus then showed Peter in verse 10, if you would have a look. Jesus says to Peter, don't be afraid. From now on, you will fish for people. And that had to amaze Peter even more than the huge catch of fish. What Peter realized then and there was the amazing grace anyone can have if they trust Jesus as their Savior. He experienced God's amazing grace, the absolution, the justification in Christ. He realized what he deserved, but he saw that God in his mercy didn't give him what he deserved. And furthermore, if that was not enough, God in his grace gave him something he didn't deserve. He gave him Jesus, his own son. And God does that for us too. In his mercy, he can forgive us. In his grace, he can give us all the riches of Christ and Christ himself. And what do we get in Christ? We get forgiveness of sins. Jesus said, hey, you might be a sinful man, but from now on, this is what you are. We also get further in that righteousness, a new purpose to life, a new purpose in Jesus. He says, from now on, you will fish for people. From now on, you will lead people to God. You will be involved in the ministry of reconciliation. And then we also get Jesus. From then on, Peter followed Jesus. And later in Jesus' ministry, when a bunch of followers were leaving him because of some things he said, he asked his followers, these men, some of them here, are you going to leave me too? And Peter said, where else can we go? You have the words of everlasting life. So we see that Jesus used this miracle to open these fishermen's eyes, these ordinary fishermen, to these amazing, life-changing realities. And that changed them dramatically. And they became radical followers of Jesus. Look in verse 11 at the result. We see that they pulled their boats ashore and they left everything and followed Jesus. That miracle catch of fish didn't matter too much to them anymore. I find that kind of funny when we focus so much on the huge catch of fish and we fail to miss the point that what they were more amazed at was Jesus, that what he said, that the realities he opened their minds to of amazing grace. They didn't care about the fish anymore. They're smelly anyways. And we can see that today, Jesus can open our eyes to those same realities, and he can dramatically change us from casual followers and to followers who are radically different from the world, followers who are on fire with the Spirit and can set others ablaze with revival, who are living in the power of the good news of Jesus. The question for us is, how will Jesus do that for us? How will he do it for me, for you? Obviously, he's not here physically to perform a miracle like that. He's not going to tell you, let's go fishing. No. But I do think that when we seek, the scripture says we will find, that those who ask will receive. So first of all, we need to pray for God to open our eyes to these three realities. And then I would say we need to realize we need to find some practical ways, some biblical ways that we can grow in our understanding of them. So I'm going to share that with you all real quick. But first, let's think about ways we can grow in the awesomeness of God, that reality. Throughout the Bible, God has pointed people to his awesomeness by his creation. So by seeing creation and pondering how great it is, how vast, and even the small things, doesn't have to just be the stars and the enormous mountains. It can be the little ants. By pondering the creation, it should create awe in us of the Creator. That's what God did to Job through chapters 38 through 41, which would be a great place to read. He amazed him of himself by showing his power in creation and creating the world. So that's one way that we can grow in the reality of the awesomeness of God. I would say the other way that Scripture shows is that we can commemorate what God has done in our lives. We can make memorials of what God has done for us. This moves to God's awesomeness for us personally, what he's done for us personally. Every prayer he answers, write it down. Every time he speaks to you from the Bible, write it down. Share it with others. Every time he convicts you, he delivers you, remember it and write it down. We need to remember what God has done, the awesomeness he is doing in our lives. So when we feel like, where is God, we can go back and look. And this is what they did in the Bible. Think about the Israelites. Was that not the reason for all of their feasts? They celebrated Passover to remember what God did for them. Remember Joshua when he crossed the River Jordan on dry ground? He told them, go get stones, and we're going to make a pile that will stand as a memorial, a monument to remember what God has done here. And we need to do that too. And when we do that, when we look at creation, when we look at what God's doing in our lives, we will grow in seeing him as he is awesome. God is awesome. The next one that we need to grow in, and one that maybe we don't really like, is we need to grow in our reality of the awfulness of sin, and particularly the awfulness of sin in us, our own sin. It's easy to focus on other people's sins, but we need to do the hard work of being quiet and sitting down, as the scripture says, sitting on your bed in quiet, I believe it says in Psalm 5, and reflecting on our iniquities and letting God search our hearts. And we need to let His Spirit convict us of the awfulness of the sin within us. We need to see sin, not just ours, every sin as awful. I think too often we get desensitized to sin. And sin is certainly not relative. I know in our culture nowadays they want to make it like right and wrong is relative. But as Christians we realize that God is the one who defines right and wrong. So what we need to do to grow in our understanding of how awful sin is, another thing that we should do is make sure we are realigning our moral compass with God's moral code. And how do we do that? By reading the Bible, by letting it convict us of what is right and what is wrong. And that's something that we need to do. Otherwise, we're like the person who has a messy car. He doesn't realize how gross his messy car is, but then his friends hop in the car and they're completely grossed out. And that may or may not be from personal experience. I'll leave that for you all to decide. Anyways, we need to see sin not as our culture does, not as anyone else does, but as God does. We need to see it as awful. We need to hate it. We need to remember that sin is wicked, that it is harmful, that it hurts us and it hurts people we love. And then, of course, we just don't end there in the awfulness of sin. No, but when we realize the awful sin, it makes this even sweeter, the amazing grace of Christ. So how can we grow in amazing grace and understanding Christ's absolution for us? I would say we need to read those great passages in Scripture that talk about our identity in Christ. We need to read the New Testament epistles, like Ephesians. We need to read the Old Testament prophecies about the Messiah, like Isaiah 42. God has used that to encourage me in times where I felt like a failure. He shows me who I am in Christ, who I am in Him. And that's what we need to do, and not only read them, we need to highlight them maybe, we need to write them down, we need to meditate on them, we need to live by them. We need to spend more time defining ourselves by not who we see in the mirror, but who we see in Christ. We need to experience on a daily basis His amazing grace for us and who we are in Him. If you trust Christ, we are a beloved child of God, a treasured possession of the Almighty One. And what a truly amazing reality that is. Another thing I think we need to point out with these realities is this is something we need to continually grow in. I think all too easily we minimize these realities. We minimize God's awesomeness. We minimize sin's awfulness. We minimize amazing grace because it's too easy to do. And when we do that, consequently, we minimize our joy in Christ, our peace, our freedom, our worship, our evangelism in Christ. And that's exactly what Satan wants to happen. So we have to be proactive. We have to be persistent. We have to be purposeful, practical, and growing in these realities and seeing them as they really are. And finally, as we come to a close, I want to point out one last thing. Our perception of reality does not change reality. It changes how we live. So in other words, what we see doesn't change what is. It changes what we do. For instance, consider someone who is a flat earth theorist. If there's anyone here who is one, I don't mean to offend you, but just because you believe the earth is flat does not make it flat. It is round. That is the reality. The earth is round. So we see that what we see, what we believe, does not change reality. So it doesn't matter if you believe God's awesome. He's awesome. It doesn't matter if you believe sin's awful. Sin is awful. It doesn't matter if you don't realize how amazing grace is. It's amazing. However, we also see that what we see, our perception of reality, can change how we live. Remember Christopher Columbus? He was one of the first ones to believe the earth was round. It wasn't flat. And based on his belief of reality, he sailed west to go east. And all the people back home thought he was crazy. But you see what happened? He found a whole new world. And that's the amazing thing. When we live in reality, we live differently. We're not living in a lie. So we see that what we see, our perception of reality, can change how we live. And that's what happened to these fishermen, and it's what needs to happen, what can happen in us. And we can become radically different followers of Jesus when we grasp these realities and we live differently as a result. So that's the challenge for us. If we want revival in our world, revival in America, revival in our communities, in our families, in our friends, it's got to start with revival in us. It's got to start with us letting God open our eyes to these realities and letting them change us, change how we live. And when we catch fire with the Lord's Holy Spirit, we can set others ablaze with revival. So that's the challenge for us. Let's live in the power of the gospel and these three realities and be radically different from the world. And let's go set the world on fire with God's love and with the gospel. Let's be radically different followers of Jesus. And this time I'd like to ask our worship leaders to please come forward and prepare to give our invitation. I don't think there's any other dog that better captures the American spirit of freedom and independence than beagles. And the reason why I can say that is my family and our neighbors have over the years had two beagles each. And all of them have had turns of getting loose. They are escape artists. They love their freedom. They love to run. And they love to track smells. And one of the most memorable times when one of the beagles got loose has to be when our neighbor's dog, Baxter, got loose. And he was enjoying his freedom. He was running. He was having the best day of his life. But there was only one problem for Baxter. He still had his leash attached to him. So as he was running through the woods, he picked up a branch there. And he picked up another branch here. Then he came to our yard. And we got little kids there, so somehow he managed to get a little kid's bike wrapped up in his leash and a couple other things. And soon his freedom was gone. He couldn't run anymore. He was exhausted. He couldn't move forward. And that's how we found him down by our playset. The dog was panting, poor dog. And he was sitting there, couldn't move forward. His freedom was gone. It didn't turn out to be as nice as what he thought. And boy, was he happy when we untangled him. He had that freedom again. Not quite, he was still on the leash, but he was happy to have that heavy burden off of him. Funny thing is, that image really stuck with my dad throughout the years. Years later, he would tell us, "All this stuff makes me feel like Baxter. I can't move forward." Ah, the joy of raising five kids, right? But I think many of us can relate to Baxter. Many of us love our freedom, but yet we feel life has a way of tying us down. Burdens just seem to come at us. The baggage of life gets all caught up in our leash, and soon we have a heavy load. From the baggage of sin, both ours and others, from mistakes, from disappointments, from maybe health problems, crises, financial stuff, I don't know. But life can just be a heavy load sometime on us, and we're no longer running free. And that's essentially what this invitation is about. The site of freedom, it's a sermon title, is the site of freedom is Jesus Christ. And he says, all who are heavy burdened, come to me and I will give you rest. He says, the one who I set free is free indeed. So Christ wants to give us rest and freedom when we come to him. And if you are not a Christian, if you are not saved, all you have to do is just come to him and trust him as your Lord and Savior to save you from the justice from God you deserve as a sinner, to save you from God's just wrath, and to give you freedom from sin and a relationship with God that will empower you to run free. And maybe for some of us Christians here today, we are Christians, but somewhere along the way, life has sucked our freedom, our joy, and our rest in Christ right out of us. And we feel just like Baxter, carrying a heavy load. This invitation is still for us. This invitation is called for us to stop trying in our own efforts and instead to trust Christ and cast our cares on him because he cares for us. Let's put down our burdens at his feet and let's trust him. God, you can work all things for our good because we love you and we're called according to your purpose. That verse, Romans 8:28, is for us Christians. And then we can experience the freedom and rest and joy in Christ again. So that is my hope for us today, that we will all choose Christ. We will all choose freedom and rest. And we would all choose to stop trying in our own strength and start trusting in what Christ did on the cross for us. It is my prayer and hope that we will know the amazing freedom of an almighty God's, everlasting God's, unconditional love for us in Christ. And that is my hope and prayer for all of us here. So let's make that decision to trust and follow Jesus. Father, I thank you for this message from your word, for the realities that we have as Christians of the amazing grace that we have in Christ. And God, I just pray that you would just revive us. Send revival in our hearts and Mount Carmel. God, help open our eyes to the realities of your awesomeness, of our sin's awfulness, and of the amazing grace in Christ. And God, help us to live differently because of those realities. Help us to be radically different followers of you, whose hearts are on fire with your Spirit, and who can set others afire with your Spirit and lead them to you so they may find the freedom and rest that we have in you. God, I pray you will bless each and every one of us, guide us, lead us, teach us, and help us to follow you and trust you. In Jesus' name, amen. Fitting for all of us as we depart to serve, for all of God's people to say, I'm following Jesus.
I'm following Jesus.
Amen. Amen.